Hello and welcome to Love Island The Morning After, the only official Love Island podcast.
And this morning we are joined by the lovely Amy Hart, Kay Curd, myself, Indra Polak, and this morning, guys, we have a very special guest. It's Dumped Islander, Samantha!
How are we all feeling this morning out of 10?
I'm with three beautiful ladies, so 10 out of 10.
I'd say an 8, maybe.
Why not 10?
Because I miss the villa.
Oh,
miss the girls.
Yeah.
Miss me girls.
Miss the sunshine.
Yeah. I brought the sunshine home with me.
Yeah, you did. Actually really warm.
Yeah.
Samantha, we have got many, many questions for you. But first of all, I want to ask you, do you have three words to sum up last night's episode?
So I'd say my three words to describe last night's episode would be excited little puppy.
And that's downplaying it.
Well, I mean, Samantha, you've been out a week now.
Yeah.
How would you say you would, like, describe your experience in the villa?
My overall experience, like, just from start to finish, it's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Mm-hmm. It's amazing. I've made friends for life in there. But, like, overall experience, I'd just say whirlwinds. Like, highs and lows, ups and downs, but... You know, I've come up the other side, so.
Yeah.
Life is a roller coaster, just got to ride it. Yeah. Ronan Keane said that. Right, now, the girls really rallied around you, and Love Island is often about the friendships, not just the love. Who are you going to be reconnecting with when they come out of the villa? Who have you been in touch with already?
So, I was out with Patsy on the weekend. We went to Girls Aloud.
I saw. Yeah. Oh, nice.
And, I love Patsy, and just all my OGs. Like Harriet, I love Harriet, Jess, and obviously Nicole, my little bestie in there, weren't she? Mimi as well, Mimi.
Yeah. Well, actually, a little birdie told us that you might be moving to London. Is that true?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Don't do it. It's overpriced. You're going to regret it after about 6 months.
I'm literally...
You'll have no money left and you'll be crying. You'll be like, send me back to Liverpool.
No, my best friend's already sending me flats regularly.
Oh,
she's
lovely.
She's like, this one. And I'm like, okay.
Is there anything in particular like you're looking forward to doing in London?
I just love being in the thick of London. I'm always here anyway. My best friend lives here and I just love it here. Just ready for a little change.
Nice little change.
A bit older, yeah.
Do you know when you're going to move down?
Sooner rather than later. Yeah, I'm living off to hotels at the minute and it's just not it.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I do like a good hotel though. You know the ones where they put little chocolate on your pillow.
You know, I always feel like no matter how fancy a hotel is, like after a while, it's just like, it just doesn't feel like home.
That's why
you need to like humble yourself and go to travel lodges. Yeah. Then you've got like a broken kettle and then you realise, oh yeah, this is like home.
See, I love bath and there's never any baths in hotels, is there?
I always get a bit weirded out about bathing at hotels. Even if there is a fancy bath, I'm just like, oh, it's a bit long.
Yeah.
And then I don't have like the bath spray to clean it out after.
Yeah.
For more cleaning tips, please.
I love a hotel. Being cabin crew for like 9 years, people used to say, oh, it's just so nice when you get home and get in your own bed. I'm like, no. When you get to a hotel, it's clean sheet night every single night. Like the biggest, comfiest bed. And you can literally phone up when your dinner comes in 45 minutes.
And that like, moment where you're like trying to like kick the sheets just to try and get them out of bed. Like,
I'm a hotel gal.
It's lovely.
I'd live in a hotel like Sweet Life of Zack and Cody.
Defo.
So let's start with Nicole and Kieran. So obviously on Sunday night we had the now infamous game of Eggy Boff. Now I thought Eggy Boff was going to be something about farts. I thought they might fly in his faces.
No, honestly, like I was like, what is this? Like Eggy, it's a smell, isn't it?
Yeah.
And then Boff.
Yeah. Anyway, they played a game. First of all, Omar was the first victim. He took it quite well. Then Kieran decided in his wisdom to play it with Nicole, who overthinks absolutely everything, as do I. She walks over, they all ignore her, and it all descends into chaos. Kieran sleeps outside on the daybed, and it's rattled on into last night's episode as well. We thought we'd already seen the argument. It turned out it was just an argument they had last week. Yeah.
They argue like once a week. It's like on round the clock, isn't it?
Yeah. They are an old married couple. We have our dinner at 6, we watch Coronation Street at 7, we argue about the game at 8, done.
Yeah, but it was his fault. When games like that come about, you know your girl, and just don't do it.
Yeah.
It's not worth the stress, just, you know what I mean? Yeah. Just be like, yes, babe, what's going on? And if the guys go, oh, you lost.
Do you think she overreacted?
I feel like she didn't know it was a game.
Yeah.
So she was well within her right to feel upset because like she didn't know it was a game. Yeah. She's come over and it's like, oh, you're ignoring me. But also, I feel like very quickly, Kira made it clear that I'm really sorry it was game. So I feel like they could have squashed out quicker than they did.
Yes.
And there was no need for him to sleep on the daybed. It could have been, babe, it was game. I'm really sorry. I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. Done.
I will say in her defense, she's obviously an overthinker, which is not a medically recognized condition, but many of us suffer from it. And I feel like it was quite humiliating for her because not only did Kieran ignore her, then you've got all the boys laughing.
It's the laughing. It's
and they're laughing at you. They're not laughing with you because you don't know what's in the game.
I think that's a
and they're like, oh, no, wait, it's only a game. So I don't know the game, so you're laughing at me.
Sorry, I think that's to do with his age. He's 21. He doesn't realise these... I mean, with age, he's going to realise you don't do those things. Yeah. And he perhaps doesn't have that level of empathy in order to put himself in her shoes and sees how it looks from her point of view. So I think it did get blown out of proportion, but I think it's just a bit of youthful ignorance there as well.
I feel like he is 21 and I think it could be seen as like quite a childish game. But also, like, can you not just like have fun with your partner? You know what I would have done? I would have gone up there and maybe chucked water on him, be like, you want to ignore me? Fine. Like, it was obviously a game.
I mean, Kieran hasn't had much time to learn empathy because he's been very, very busy.
Yes.
Because apparently, he slept with 120 girls. Now, I would say that's quite a rounded number. Like, I
over mean, 120.
Oh, it was over.
It was 100. Because I think that was Ronnie's number. That was Ronnie's number. And he said he slept with more than Ronnie, I think. So, yeah.
I mean, how do we feel about that? Do we think, like, a high body count is seen maybe as a
red flag? I think it's mad at 21.
Mm. Yeah.
I'm like, where did you find the time, bro? Did he go uni? Did he sleep? What happened?
Yeah. He did, but I'm sure he dropped out.
I can see why.
he didn't get any lectures at all.
Wasn't going to any lectures, bro. Like, because you start working that out at 21, you're like, how many was that a week? And like, do you know what I mean? It's just crazy. But yeah, like, this is man, credit to him if that's how he wants to live his life.
He's
who
honest.
Who am I to judge?
Who are you to judge? Probably the issue for Nicole is obviously they're from very small towns in Wales. So when she goes out clubbing, all 120 might be there.
Yeah.
They're only 20 minutes away from each other as well, aren't they? So yeah, it probably is.
She probably knows some of the 120.
Yeah.
Like that's probably the
issue.
Might
be invited to the wedding.
Goodness me.
And it won't be like, does anyone
if
have
anybody
any reason?
Has any reason not to get these two wedded? It's just like, I have
not. It should have been me. I mean, he was going from the IO school of thought that he was honest. He could have lied about it. Yeah. He could have said 10, but then when they turned up to the club in Wales and they were all there, like, I've slept with your boyfriend.
I love that. IO's probably like reassuring him, like, yeah, like at the end of the day, you've done nothing wrong, bro. Yeah. You've just told her the truth. Yeah. If she don't like it, you weren't to know that. That's IO all over, innit?
To be fair, I feel like, you know what, he was honest.
Yeah.
But I can understand why that would make Nicole feel a little uneasy because I feel like sleep with whoever you want to, but that high of a number, sometimes it could also give off like you've got no self-control.
Yeah.
I'm sure, if he's
if he's single and he's young and he's 6'3" or whatever and he's good looking.
He's trying his best.
As long as he's single.
Well, as long as he's single and safe.
Single and safe. Yeah, single and safe.
I just think...
It doesn't matter to you. So the number doesn't matter to you. Would you ask your partner?
Oh, I just wouldn't ask. I would never want to know that information personally.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
I'd rather not know.
But also, I think what's gained from asking that question? Because now, as you said, she's an overthinker. So she's going to overthink so many scenarios about that.
Yeah.
And she can't change the situation. She can't change what he's done. He can't change his past. So what benefit is there to ask?
I think it's a little bit of insight.
Yeah.
Just to know what you were like in your past life. You know how many girls you were pulling and just what you were up to. I want to know.
Have you asked your partner?
Yeah, I think I have asked Sammy.
Oh, wow.
But I can't remember what it was. It wasn't anything that I was like shocked by because it was just sort of like, oh, whatever, you're here now.
As well, surely that's like comforting for Nicole because she knows that he's gone out, he's sowed his seeds, he's got it out of his system and he's ready to be a faithful boyfriend. I like to see a positive in every situation.
Yeah, whereas I don't think Nicole is seeing it from the positive side. She's thinking, wow, you've done 120, have you got more in you?
Yeah. Like
at 21, he probably does, if I'm being honest with you.
It's time to dish out our pre-love serves of the week with official headline sponsor, eBay. Bombshell will kick things off by stepping out into the villa in a tropical Tasso Elba Island shirt. He scored another win, coupling up with Umar in her fire rat and boa starburst dress and this stussy jacket. A classic pick worn by Shaq and Tom in Series 9, Mehdi in Series 10, and Adam during All-Stars. Kinda jealous I didn't get to wear it because that pink would have looked ravishing on me during the villa parties. Meanwhile, old flames were rekindled for Joey and Grace in the hideaway, with Joey wearing this Givenchy t-shirt. Just another week of pre-love summer. Discover more villa-inspired looks on eBay today. Fashion fit for a second chance. eBay, sponsors of Love Island.
We're talking about Turbo Ronnie. Guys, is he back?
What is Turbo Ronnie?
Right. I don't even know.
He tell us. You said 2 weeks in
advance. I don't know what it is.
He called himself Turbo Ronnie. Now, I don't actually know what the term Turbo Ronnie means, but maybe because he's just going from girl to girl. Yeah. It's like Turbo Ronnie.
Yeah, because he called himself T-Dog at one point, and I was cringed when he said it.
T-Dog. I mean, okay, so Harriet chose Ronnie in the recoupling. She did say that she believes in second chances and that, you know, Ronnie was saying he's a changed man. Mm. Do we believe this?
No.
His second chance was 2 weeks ago. I swear we're on like number 14 now. I'm really confused by the numbers.
If you were Harriet, would you guys be giving Ronnie a second chance?
No.
He's had a fair few.
But there's no one else in there.
I was going to say, there's not a wide dating pool.
I mean, Sam, you've obviously been in the villa. Mm. You've seen Harriet and Ronnie in person. Would you say that they've got, you know, chemistry and maybe there's certain things that we aren't seeing?
I mean, like, I feel like away and ever in it, like a group setting with them to like go, oh, look at them two. Like they were always just kind of on their own, doing their own thing when they were in the villa. But like clearly there is something there for them to keep going back to each other. Like you do gravitate towards each other, obviously.
I did actually mention on After Sun, I don't know why, but I just have this gut feeling that Ronnie has always liked Harriet.
Yeah.
And all the things that has happened between them, like, you know, the little wind-up argument, you know, Harriet crying in the dressing room and he's eavesdropping through the door. I don't know. I just feel like there's always that one person in your life that can get under your skin, and that is Harriet for Ronnie. Like, I don't know. They just have that sort of...
They did look they annoy each other, but it's kind of like a together love language. On that date, but you don't base relationships off aesthetics.
No. I think they're going to continue to wind each other up. Mm. I think that they potentially, if Casa Amor happens, will both bring someone back and be just laughing at each other, wind each other up, keep going away together, and I do think they'll be in that final together.
I don't even think he really liked Tiffany. I think the thing was Tiffany wasn't as on him as the other girls were, and for him that was a bit of a shock. So that's why he sort of like went, oh my God, I'm going to put all my eggs in this basket. Yeah. So that's why he was sort of pursuing that, whereas he's sort of used to just like girls, you know, chasing him. So he's just a bit like, yeah, well, whatever. And he sort of, in a way, takes the mick a little.
Yeah. I mean, an alternative view, if you are a Love Island connoisseur like me, the public are a sucker for a man who darts around, is a bit of a lad, and then becomes a bit of a wet mop for one particular girl.
The journey, eh?
The journey.
The journey.
You want a reformed bad man.
And people love it.
He does have an air of an EastEnders villain about him.
He does.
Do you know what I mean? Like, he does feel like he's going to walk into the Queen Vic.
I was thinking about to say, with, like, the papers and be like, I own this pub now.
It's my pub now. Harriet. Come in.
Yeah. She comes in a jacket. I'm really sorry that you've been like kicked out on Christmas Day, but like
I mean, Ronnie on that day also told Harriet that he thinks his family really like her. Do we agree? Like, family approval is very important.
Yeah, it is. I think especially if you're planning on sharing a life with somebody.
Yes.
If it's going to get to that point, then of course, like your family, they're going to be part of your family. They need to mix with them and they need to be able to get along with them, don't they? Absolutely. Do you know what I mean?
I agree. But imagine if you just really love someone. Like, you can't help who you fall in love with, whether your family get on with them or not. Mm. I wouldn't, like, split up with someone because my family didn't approve.
I agree.
Personally.
I mean, I think it would be hard, though, after a while.
I mean, my family haven't approved of half the people that I've
met. And here she is on Love Island. We actually met Ronnie's mum and sister, and they were big fans of Jess.
They were.
Yeah. And, I mean, maybe they saw something that we didn't, because did we realise that Jess was still so hung up on Ronnie?
You know what? I was actually taken by surprise when she was, you know, confessing her basically still love for him.
Yeah.
I think she's just bored.
I was going to say, she's bored.
She's in that villa bored, seeing everybody else in bed cuddling, and she's just like...
When we were all in group situations and things like that, you could always see her looking at him and things like that. Like, I feel like she never stopped.
But do you know what it is? That's like, you know when, like, you like someone at work?
Yeah.
But it's just because they're around, isn't it? Because you're like, I wouldn't really like this person if I didn't spend so much time with them in this place. So I think because there isn't anybody else in the villa for her, he's the only one where, like, there's a level of sort of intimacy. So that's why that closeness, I think, makes her just go, oh, that could be the one.
I think she really liked him from the get-go. Like, from the get-go. Yeah, like, just from, they were kissing, like, straight away and, like, things like that. I think she's always liked Ronnie.
Do you think then potentially, like, how far do you think Ronnie and Harriet are going to go? Do you think there's any scope? Obviously, we saw him let her down gently.
Yeah.
But do you think there's any room at all for maybe Jess and Ronnie to pick things up again?
No, I can't really see them. No, I think when she picked Sean on that recoupling, Ronnie was like, nah. Like, I feel like that really bruised his ego kind of thing, which...
Embarrassed me in front of all my friends.
Plus, they'd be called Johnny, and that's not really a nickname you want to have, innit?
Rariot.
Or no, it was Honey. Harrows and Ronners.
Yeah, couple name would be
Honey. Really cute.
Now it's time for the best Sky Mobile me moments. This series has been full of Islanders embracing their me energy, and we've been obsessed. Let's count down the best moments so far where our Islanders have put themselves and their needs first. In third place, we have Jess knowing she's the prize.
Two, remember, I am the prize.
Know your worth, you are the prize. And second place goes to Mimi choosing to steal Io.
So the boy I've decided to steal is Io.
Yes, Mimi. And the current number one moment is Uma and Harriet talking about standing on business.
Like, think about what you want to do. That's what's best for yourself. Because I'm thinking about the way that I've looked at it is what's best for me, you know? And then stand on business.
Cheers to that, Crane.
Cheers to that, baby.
Personally, I'm here for that advice. Sky Mobile is a network that lets you to switch your phone and data plan to suit you. Switch to Sky Mobile today.
We saw in last night's episode, Ronnie did let Jess down easy. Yeah. And he did say the words of, oh, you know, I want nothing but the best for you and that she deserves better. And he just wants someone to come in and treat her right.
Yeah.
Do we think it's high time that maybe Jess just throws a tile and just says, you know what? I'm going to move on.
When a man says, you deserve better than me, it means, basically. It basically means, I'm not going to treat you like you want to be treated in it.
And I can't be bothered to try.
Exactly. Like, I can't be asked to buy you flowers.
Yeah.
I've been on the website. I've seen the delivery costs. For me, the feelings aren't there to part with that money for this. I think once she heard that, she should have just been like, alarm bells ringing.
Yeah. It was also how awkward it was that she'd gone over to have a conversation with him.
Yeah.
To like try and like win him back a bit or try and get closure. But I've got friends who are like, I'm not going to block them because I want that closure. I want to have it out of them. Like, no, you're not blocking them because you want them to text and ask you out again. So I think she went over there to be like, I need to get closure.
Do we believe in closure?
Well, would you want Joey to have spoken to you like that rather than just come back and, you know, be with Grace?
Yeah, I would prefer the conversation, yeah.
Yeah. I think it's like having that transparency and just knowing where you stand with someone.
Yeah, and I got no conversation.
So yeah. I think we've all been there when you're like, I just wish they'd tell me they didn't want to see me. It's like, you know, you have a party and people don't make excuses. You're like, if you don't want to come, just say you don't want to come. But then if someone actually said to you, I don't want to come to your party, you'd be like, oh my God, like, you don't want to come. That's really hurtful. So I feel like it's like that. She's like, I want closure. But she's like, not that closure. I wanted you to have closure with Harriet and then come back to me.
Yeah.
It's a tough one because I see it from Ronnie's perspective where he's now trying to get somewhere with Harriet and you don't just really want to go, look, Jess, like, this ain't going anywhere, like, that explicitly. But in her, like, tunnel vision for Ronnie, she's taken what he said in the completely wrong way.
We might get like a little sit down HR meeting between
she's
Jess, Ronnie, and Harriet.
Yeah.
And like, she'll say what she thinks
Ronnie
said, and he'll be like, I didn't say that. And then we'll have to just move on to movie night and it'll all go. But Jess obviously did go back to Harriet and relayed it slightly differently.
Slightly altered the truth, just a smidge.
I think there's two schools of thought here. It's, is that what she heard?
She needs subtitles on Ronnie. When Ronnie speaks, like, I think she can't understand Cockney.
Yeah.
She's from up north or whatever. So it's like she can't hear what he said, probably.
Or do you think it was her final kick at Harriet? Like, do you know what? I've lost this battle, but I feel like I need to throw my last little thing in the ring and wind you up because after this, the triangle's done. Their war has been going on, like, since sort of week one.
They genuinely get on when they're not...
Okay.
Arguing.
Yeah.
In the villa, we all got on. So when I'm seeing them bickering, I'm just like, girls, pack it in. Like, it needs to be kind of put to bed and left. But then at the same time, there was always digs. Like, one would throw one, then another one would throw one. And then you'd be like...
Well, I saw it when Jess walked back from her chat with Ronnie, the girls that sat in the bed were like, you're right, babe. Like, and Harriet literally went from the top down to the bottom, like looked her up and down, and then was like, you're right. I don't think it's ever going to end. I feel like in six weeks' time, like, we'll be at the reunion.
They're always going to have that. I haven't watched it all back, but there was always like little digs back and forth between the both of them. And like, you'd just be sat there like...
I mean, Harriet did say that she feels like there's no girl code in there. Do we agree? Do we really feel like, you know, after watching Harriet go on a date with Ronnie, it was necessary for Jess to come over and be like, well, he said this about me. It's like... now's not the time to try and, like, confess your feelings, you
think? It's one of them in the villa, isn't it? You never know when your time's up.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's true.
But also, if you don't like someone, like, let me ruin their day, innit? Like, I don't care if you've had a good day. Like, I want you to hurt, right? Like, and when is the best time? After you've been on a date. Let me just bring you back down to earth and let's see if you're really that well-spoken.
Yes, there may have been no girl code from Jess. I feel like they're probably quite even in the no girl code, like, league tables. Done, I think they're both very strong characters. One is representing the North, one is representing the South, and the battle is on.
Jess will, like, instigate it, and then Harriet's like, and, like, I think Harriet's just Harriet, isn't she?
Yeah.
But, like, Harriet went back down either.
No.
Like, I think at first she half used to, and then I think as, like, the weeks have come on, she's like, no.
Yeah.
No, I think she's, like, remembers who she is.
And I feel like Harriet's very direct, so I'm interested to see in tonight's episode. I feel like she's going to go to Ronnie and be like, so what did you say? Again?
Yeah.
And I feel like Jess knows whatever she says to Harriet, Harriet is going to take it literally and think that is what it is.
Do you think there's elements of her, like, feeling like a princess?
It was, like, a conversation in the villa. It was kind of like, she's just never been told no, so when she is, you'll know she's female.
This sort of situation, we'll find out tonight sort of how it pans out, but that's not the end of the battle. Ronnie has said that he doesn't want to be with Jess. That's fine. So you'd think on paper that's the end, but it's not, because if Ronnie goes off with anyone else, Jess will be there again. I told you. Like, the battle will never end.
Yeah.
Ever.
She'll always be there to remind Harriet that maybe Ronnie just isn't the one for you.
Yeah. Talking of battles, we had one tonight between Connor and Joey.
I feel like after that situation Omar and Joey had, I was a little bit surprised as to why he reacted that way to Omar. But then when Connor's doing the same thing, you're like, oh, don't worry about it. I feel like he was kind of just, like, bluffing a little bit. Because we saw him going to the beach, I'm like, I'm absolutely livid.
You see? You know
what I mean? I think there might be an element that he was actually threatened by Omar and not by Connor. But it's hard to be mad at Connor when he's like, hello, mate. Yeah. And you're just like, oh, man, teach me how to, like, put sticky back plastic on my book, man. Like, how can you be angry at him?
Yeah, you can't be angry at Connor.
Connor just looks like he's just everybody's best mate, and I just can't see him getting on the wrong side of anybody. So.
No. I mean, I feel like he was sort of led on a bit by Grace. I feel like when she went over and he's like, well, I like you. And then she's like, gets picked by him and she's like, I'm really shocked by this. I just don't understand why he would think that I was open to me being picked.
Yeah, I thought it was a bit of a bizarre situation, but it kind of reminds me, I don't know. It's like, you know when you flirt your way into a relationship, it's like, oh, I didn't mean for it to go this far.
Yeah.
I feel like that's what she did, because she sat around that fire pit and looked shocked when Connor was like, Grace. Do you know what I mean? But you opened that door.
That was
for
him. Kieran's argument about how he got to 120. He just flirted his way
there. He didn't even know.
I think it was quite funny because she goes to him, oh, yeah, you owe it to yourself to explore all these connections. And if you need anybody to speak to in the villa, I'm here.
He just told you that he fancied you. So what do you mean if you need anyone to speak to in the villa?
Like, because I think she started off trying to flirt. And then when she was like, well, listen, if you've got any questions or anything, like
she
was
giving
him a pamphlet.
Like,
she was giving him a pamphlet about how Love Island works. Like, so, yeah, recoupling's every Sunday and, toilets are over there and daybed's there. So, yeah, enjoy your stay. Yeah. So it just felt a bit...
You can go in the hideaway and wait whenever you want.
It was just honestly a bit, like, I didn't really understand why she even pulled him for a chat anyway. Because if you're, like, what are you talking to him about? If you're
going to be, like, I think she did to wind Joey up.
Really?
Yep. Like I said on After Sun the other day, he puts everything on everyone else. So when he split up with Samantha, he put it all on Samantha. When they're in the bottom four, he then suddenly was like, oh, it's because you spoke to Omar. I mean, Grace must know that they're in the bottom because of Joey's actions in the past
week. Yeah, he doesn't take accountability for his actions.
So I think she did it to wind him up.
I disagree. I don't think she's trying to wind him up. Like, I feel like she backtracks a lot.
Yeah.
And I feel like she wants to explore her options, but she doesn't want to let Joey down. Because we saw it. I feel like with Omar leaving, that kind of sent a rocket up to her to, like, oh, maybe I should explore. She was about to do it with Connor. And again, she just backtracked because she's thinking, well, how am I actually going to tell Joey this?
We need them to send them on a date to get her away from Joey to see if she actually... Because, again... When Joey stood there, she can't be like, oh, my God, I got picked. She's got to be like, oh, my God, this is really shocking news to me. I'm really angry about this situation, guys. Yeah. It's so annoying. She can't be happy about it. So I'd love to see them taken away from the situation and see how she unfolds.
But, I can't see Connor and her, like, ever going anywhere.
No, I don't I don't think they're a well-suited match. But, you know, there's that thing called Catherine Moore. It may or may not happen.
I think she was as Omar.
Why do you think that her and Omar were so well-suited? Did you see quite a lot of, you know, interaction between them when you were in the villa?
He has a lot of good chats initially, and then obviously he was her type to a T.
Yeah.
And like she has said numerous times what a type is, so you would think that she'd just be a bit more suited to Omar.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, it is funny that but she's with Joey, but like the two guys she's been interested in are like the complete opposite
but
of Joey.
But there's no denying like her and Joey's sexual connection, like, is there. Like, it is.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. I feel like that's a given when it's like an old flame, that you're always going to have that sexual chemistry. So that I feel like that's where they're at that advantage, because it's not their first time meeting. They had history.
Yeah.
I don't know, she owes it to herself to explore.
Yeah.
And I said it on After Sun and I still stand by it. I don't understand going into a villa and coupling up with your ex.
Yeah.
I mean, there's other reality TV shows.
Ex on beach, maybe.
From old flames to new flames, we've got Sean and Matilda.
Oh.
The little bubbly puppies. I love them.
Sean is scaring me. I think he's the kind of guy that changes his relationship status on Facebook immediately after going on a date. I think.
And if they have a row, changes it, it's complicated.
Yeah.
So proud.
Yeah, I think he needs to act like he's been here before, because it does feel a bit like, oh my God, like shouting over
the
terrace, going, oh guys, I've had my first kiss.
Oh no.
Like that. If any one of my friends did that, they would never hear the end of it from me forever and ever and ever.
Do you not think he was just being a bit of like a proud partner? Or would you guys be
But that's
like...
fine after you've proposed, on like your first kiss with somebody. I just think that's a bit too much, and it comes like, play it a little bit cooler than that. I know Matilda says she doesn't like guys that play it cool, but like... Yeah. Flipping it, some composure.
I was going to say, the other boys in the villa have literally come under fire from, like, all the girls in the villa, because they're not telling everyone how they feel. They're, like, double-crossing everyone. Mm. Sean is just like, I really like you. I think he's really sweet.
But, like, he's the kind of like, I'm going to pick you up from work, and then I'm going to bring you back from work, and I'm going to spend the evening together, and we're going to go to the films. And it's just like, let her breathe, brother.
I think she likes it. I think...
Yeah, she does.
And she knows his journey. And I feel like, you know, everyone loves someone that comes in and sweeps the unlucky in love off their feet. She's probably quite proud. It probably gets her a bit of gravitas in the villa as well. Everyone's been rooting for Sean.
Going to, like, fill a whole hotel room up with watermelon slices, going, you said it was your favourite. Like, it's that kind of vibe.
I think that is actually so sweet. Yeah. I feel like, for me, announcing that you've had a kiss, I feel like that was just, like, unnecessary, because I feel like that could potentially back Matilda into a corner.
Yeah.
And like her seeing him so excited about the kiss might make her feel like, oh God, no, I know I can't leave him. I feel a bit bad. But on the grand scheme of things, I think it's actually quite nice to be vocal about how much you like your partner.
Yeah, be vocal. Like, oh, I'm a lover boy.
I'm so proud.
Like the butterfly thing got me. Butterflies.
Yeah, that one, you could have kept that one.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. Like, I just think a lot of it is like, keep some of it to yourself.
Yeah,
like,
that's him, he's excited.
There is ways of telling the person that you're with that you're into them without making it sound like it's your first time talking.
This is all that he's wanted for weeks now. Do you know what I mean? So it's nice to see.
For weeks, it feels like it's what he's wanted for years and years.
Yeah.
What are you saying about having butterflies and stuff? Again, you know, like in Greece when they come back from their like summer of love and Danny's like, yeah, it was all right. And Sandy's like, oh my God, it was amazing. I feel like Matilda looked really happy after the kiss as well.
Yeah.
So you're sort of being like, finally got my kiss, doesn't matter who. I love the fact that he's like, no, I got butterflies, I really like you. And I think as well, she's very bubbly. I feel like you wouldn't do that to you with Mimi.
If Sean had a way to like send breaking news updates to everybody's phone in the world, he would have done that.
The way he segued himself into being in a couple with Matilda, he had to be this excited because he made it very clear he did not want
it. Well, he got someone sent home.
Like, he literally made it so clear, I don't want that man here. So, you know, he got what he wanted.
Yeah.
You know, it was a bit dirty Mackin behaviour, but he did it and he got what he wanted and he got his kiss. So.
Poor Omar, you'll be missed.
Well, we also heard Matilda and Grace both say that they're into PDA. Are we all PDA fans or is it a bit too much?
Like, it depends what level.
Why does I say that?
You neck on the tube.
I've never necked on the tube in my life. I don't know why I said that. I love PDA. Yeah. I am a PDA person.
Yeah.
I'm now quoting you to you. I'm a super fan of you now.
I don't mind PDA, but I think it also depends who the audience is. So like when there's family involved, oh my God, Dami, don't touch me.
Yeah.
See, I don't know, when family's around,
I find
like,
it weird at weddings.
Touch me.
Like even a bride and groom are kissing, I'm like, ooh.
Yeah,
like,
we don't kiss. No.
Yeah, at my wedding, we're going to be like, you may kiss the bride like on the cheek. Like we have a baby, but obviously we don't snog, like don't worry about it.
Forehead kiss, but, cheers, thanks.
Forehead kiss is actually the most unselfish of any kisses because the person giving the forehead kiss doesn't get anything from it.
Yeah.
Apart from your common sense.
And foundation. Well, guys, on that note, it's the end of our morning chat. Aww. It's been so good. Kay, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having
Kay
me.
Kay will also be with us for the whole week. And Sam, thank you for joining us this morning. It's been an absolute pleasure chatting to you.
Thank you.
Please don't forget to subscribe to our podcast and let us know anything you want to see more of in the comments below. Guys, and make sure you give us a 5-star rating because we will give you a 5-star show. And again, thank you for watching. Bye.
We're off to the estate agents to find her a flat.
And a man.